keep you free and clean. Now you wear your skin like iron, breath is hard as kerosene. Weren't you mama's only boy?
Working with Towns, starting this book a year before he died, he opened up about everything. And so, you know, I got to hear that, you know, from the beginning, and, you know, as much as he could remember. But one of the things he spoke about was how when he was in college, how he listened to Lightnin' Hopkins, Hank Williams, you know, and Dylan. And, you know, time passes, and then Towns gets to meet Dylan here in Austin, and then he meets him in Nashville. And Towns often said, you know, man, I'd love to do a project with Dylan. Well, I have an old friend, Bob Johnston, that produced four albums on Bob Dylan. So I arranged for Towns to meet Bob, and we talked about it, and he said, yeah, let's do it, Harold, but there's gonna be a problem. And he said, can I talk to you, you know, by yourself? Towns went outside, and he says, well, the problem that's going to be is Dylan's going to be hiding behind the couch, and Towns is going to be passed out on it.
Harold had a lot of different kinds of relationships with Towns, everything from business to production. But I think the most important one was the friendship and the time they actually spent together. And I know that this heartfelt book is full of these stories. And I thought tonight it'd be fun to hear just some of your favorites, some that you'd like to share with us.
Yes, in this book I felt really proud that I was able to set the record straight on Towns. They always said he was drunk and falling down all the time. That's not true. Austin was his hometown, and that's where he went crazy. And that's what the Austinites saw. Should I say how I met Towns? And
that'd be the great way to begin. Not everyone knows that, I bet.
Well, when I was in 1968, my brother started a label called Poppy, and the first artist that was on it was Towns, and he brought him out to the house to meet the family, and Towns basically became a family member. My mom and everyone, he'd go to family functions and became godfather and, you know, became part of the family. And then in 1977, I started road managing him. My brother started a new label called Tomato, and that album was recorded in Nashville, Flying Shoes, and that's where I started with him going out on the road. He says, first of all, we work together, you don't work for me. If you ever feel like you work for me, I want you to quit. So there was always that camaraderie. He felt as though he was Jesse James and I was in his gang and his band members. And he said he'd roll into town, we'd get the money and leave before they knew what we did. He kept telling me, you know, Harold, this life I live is very dangerous. And I said, what are you talking about, man? You play to the girls and, you know, hey, go from town to town. He said, no, you don't get it. He says, there's guns and knives and there's jealous boyfriends and husbands, and you can get killed. And he said, well, Harold, don't ever forget that if you're in a cage with a monkey, you're a monkey too. So it's 3 a.m, and a lot of times it was the driving all night that I enjoyed the most because there's no cars on the road. And I used to love to get up behind the trucks and get caught in draft. And he would freak out. He said, what are you trying to do? Kill us, guys, kill us? I said, no, Towns, you're trying to kill me. You know, and then he would ease up. So that was a way I could get him when it got too intense. I would do that. And then he knew, okay, I'll lighten up if you lighten up, you know. So he would go from very high, happy, to very sad, very quickly. And in fact, that's why I put so many albums out with him, because of the same songs, because they were never the same guy. One of the last things that I heard Towns, his last words, is when I was leaving, I dropped him off New Year's Eve. I was catching a flight back to Austin. And he says, H, you're deserting me. And I said back, Towns, you've already had dessert. And he laughed. And that's what I did the whole time I was with him. I learned how to pull him out of the darkness. And he would do the same for me. you know, I felt like the student in the back of the room, you know, trying to communicate with the teacher in the front. It was very draining. And, you know, it was funny because after Towns died, you know, we've been up and down that highway so much, the highways of the world, that all of a sudden I found myself in San Marcos. And it dawned on me that the white line of the highway was Towns' footprints, and I was following them. Yeah, it was hard at times, but it made me laugh because, you know, as much as like people say, oh, Towns was such a sad story, but they don't understand. He lived the life he wanted. He did what he wanted all the time, whether it was Demolition Derby or laughing or, I mean, he was truly, there was an innocence there with it from the very beginning. What I did realize is my position with Towns was he was the train. I rushed up and just barely caught my hand on the caboose and held on for dear life. And his favorite cover of Pancho and Lefty is when we were somewhere and there was a young kid trying to play it. And he was stumbling through it. And he said, you know, Harold, that's the best version I've ever heard. I always liked being the shadow of Towns, you know. Trying to keep up with it was another story. But he was truly my best friend. I hope I was his. But he always said to me, you know, H, I'd rather play to a small club. I don't know if I can silence 10,000 people. Then all of a sudden, I got a call from the Cactus, from Griff. And Towns was playing, and he was in bad shape. And Griff says, Harold, you got to come down. I don't know what to do, whether to give tickets back or let him go on stage. So I went down. And it was a rough show. And I made a point of Towns not seeing me. And so he went back to the dressing room, and I came in, and he jumped up, and he said, H, man, it's so good to see you. Will you come back on the road with me? And I said, you bet, man. And he was my best friend. And if he showed up, I'd do it again. These great lines I always loved was, it's the going, not the getting there. And I realized that, you know, in doing this book, yeah, it's great, but, you know, there's a part of me that's very sad because I got there. I was sound asleep, and I woke up, and the dog was barking, you know, outrageously. And the lights were going off and on for about 3 minutes. And then they went back, and the dog calmed down. And then the call came in, and said, Towns died. And I said, yeah, I know. He came by to say goodbye.